better control over his bat than Ted Williams. What a hitter.
One of the all-time greats, Sam. And it was an honor to have Ted as a guest on the Baseball Bunch. Kool-Aid Man.
Okay, chickens. Go out there and give nice, tasty pitches for a rat. That's a tricky now.
Hey, I think you got something there, Sam. Come out early, get some extra BP, and pow! Up and away goes the old BA.
BA?
Bachelor of Arts to Student, Sam. To us, it means batting average.
Oh. Okay, chicken, how about feed me a good old F-O? Put it in here.
F-O?
Fat one, Jesse. Let us hitters feed a nice, lazy fastball. Put it in here, chicken.
Finally happened. The bird flipped his lid.
Put it in here, chick. Holy mackerel! The chicken lost his marble and his glove. Let's try to help him.
I knew chickens are pretty good fly catchers, but I'd like to get that fly out of your glove.
Hey, mister, what are you doing here? We came here for some extra batting practice, not fishing practice.
Well, I want to tell you, fishing and batting are my two favorite subjects. And in order to be a good fisherman, you have to have a little science and certainly have to have some art. But when it comes to batting, now you're really talking about something that requires science and art. Because hitting a baseball, I've always said, was the hardest single thing to do in sports.
Boy, you said it. I haven't had a hit in weeks.
Well, I want to tell you now, maybe this bat has got two strikes against you already because it's a pretty heavy one.
Maybe Sam's too heavy for the bat.
Babe Ruth wasn't too heavy.
Yeah, but he wasn't a string bean either. I'll tell you, he was a big, strong guy. And when I talked to him, he was using the heaviest bat that was ever used. But the modern player found out that by using a light bat, he could wait longer.
You mean you really knew Babe Ruth?
Yeah, I had a chance to meet Babe Ruth. And you know, he wasn't a thin guy or a skinny guy. He was a big, strong guy.
What's going on here?
And I also had a chance to talk to Ty Cobb and to Rogers Hornsby, two of the greatest hitters that ever lived.
Do you know who that fisherman is? That's Ted Williams, who some people call the greatest hitter in baseball history.
You're right. It's one of those things that I'll never forget. I had meeting Gavin a chance.
Ted Williams was only 20 years old when he came to the Red Sox in 1939, and he had one of the greatest rookie seasons ever. A serious student of the science of hitting, Williams only got better. They called him the Kid, the Splendid Splinter, the Thumper, and later, Teddy Ballgame. In 1941, his home run in the bottom of the ninth won the All-Star game for the American League. For the remainder of that season, Ted ripped line drives at a rate never seen before. Had he not played on the last day of the season, Ted would have become the first player in 11 years to bat 400. But he put it all on the line that day, and he blasted six hits and a doubleheader. His final average, 406. His career spanned four decades, but finally in 1960, he came to bat for the last time. The result, home run number 521. He won six batting titles, two triple crowns, and two MVP awards. To many, he was the greatest hitter of all time.
Johnny, if Ted Williams is really the best ever, I want to see him hit.
Well, Ted retired more than 20 years ago, so I don't think he came here to do that. But he did come here to help us all, and you can bet I'm going to be listening carefully.
First thing we're going to have to be concerned with is plate coverage. And then we might have to choke up in the bat to make it feel a little lighter. Huh? We want to flex our knees, be a little loose, comfortable. And then as the pitcher gets ready to throw the ball, we have to cock ourselves, looking at the pitcher all the time,
And then we start our swing into the ball. Right. Very good, Sam. Very good. Say, here's my friend Johnny Bench. Let's see where he gets his power from.
Huh?
Maybe. Let's see. Big, strong guy. Johnny Bench. He's been a great hitter. He's been the kind of hitter I like. He had some sting to what he did with the bat. I would have liked to have had a chance to talk to Johnny Bench a little more as a younger player.
Mike Schmidt.
He's a big, powerful athlete. He has enough power to hit him out of right center, pretty near as easily as left center. He's strong enough to still hit the ball out of the alleys, and so consequently, he's a pretty hard article to deal with.
Ken Singleton.
He's a switch hitter. I'll tell you about Ken Singleton. I think that he has got control of his strike zone the last 4 or 5 years to the point where he gets good balls to hit now.
Keith Hernandez.
I think Hernandez for St. Louis is as good a looking hitter as there is in the game today. And I think, from what I hear, the St. Louis Park is not made to order for hitting.
Rod Carew.
I call him a great ping hitter. He can hit the bat on the ball, and he can hit anybody. And as outstanding and as great as he is as a hitter, I still think that he should have hit more home runs. He can hit more home runs.
Boy, Ted, you sure know a lot about hitting. Come on, show us your stuff.
Wait a minute, Rick. No, I told you didn't come here for that, all right?
Well, come on, Rick. You come on up here and take a couple of cuts.
Yeah.
Hey!
Right, there you go.
There you go. Give him a little room now. Okay, now let me see you take a couple of good cuts. We're going to look you over. Boy, I have to say, that's a pretty good swing.
Why is that a good swing?
Well, it's level, but he's swinging at a high pitch. I'd like to see him swing at a low pitch. Let me see you swing at a low pitch, Rick. Same thing. You're going to hit it hard to left field. Oh, that's good. Now, you know what he did there, John? He was level, but another thing he did, and do it once more. Very good. He went down to the ball. He went down to the ball, which is great. And that way, you can maintain a level swing and still hit a low ball good because you're going down to the low ball swing. Let me see you swing at a high pitch now. High pitch. All right, that's all right. Now let me see you swing at a low pitch. See the difference? He came down to the ball, which is very good, Rick. Very good. No wonder you're a good hitter.
All right.
Rick.
Yeah, boy, nice going. That was good.
Come on, Ted, let's see your swing.
Wait a minute. Sometimes taking a pitch is more important than swinging at it. Chicken, why don't you go over and get some balls and a hammer, and we'll really learn a little about science of hitting.
Oh, there we have it, Bunch. The science of hitting.
Wow, that was beautiful.
Ah! Chicken, you always did stick out like a sore thumb.
But, Ted, I don't get it. Which ball do you hit?
Well, now, that's an interesting question, and this is a very interesting display because it shows the balls that were the best for me to hit. And you can see this area right in here, 330, 340, 400. And as you get down to the lower outside part, it comes further away from you, a much tougher pitch to hit. And I try to lay off those pitches as much as I could. And I asked a great hitter one time, in fact, I asked all the great hitters that I had a chance to talk to, what was the single most important thing that I had to do to become a good hitter? But Rogers Hornsby told me the biggest secret of it all. He said, you got to get a good ball to hit. Now, what does that mean? It means a ball in a good area. It means a ball that hasn't fooled you. Up to two strikes, you get a good ball. And then after two strikes, you do have to concede something to the pitcher so you don't become a strikeout king. And you say, well, now I've got to hit the ball. So I concede to the point I'm going to hit that ball right back hard through the box. Any questions? Yes.
Ted, is the science of hitting for everyone?
That's a great question because this chart isn't for everybody. Because some people might have liked the ball away more than I did, or they might have liked the ball in more than I did. There's inside hitters, there's outside hitters, there's low ball hitters, and there's high ball hitters. So you see, Bunch, this was the best area for me, right in here. And I knew that this was my happy zone, that I could do the best work when the ball was in that area. What's your happy zone, Sam?
Oh, right here, of course. I'm so choosy. I mean, it takes me 5 or 6 swings just to hit one ball.
Most of the time that you miss the ball, it's either you've been fooled or it's in a tough spot. And that's probably the reason that it takes you so many balls, because a lot of the balls that you hit, nobody could hit very well.
That's right, Sam. As a catcher, you just wouldn't believe some of the pitches some of these hitters in the major league swung at.
Wow, thing. love you. But I wanna know for sure. Come on, hold me tight. Wow, babe.
Boy, that was a good swing. Why'd you swing at it?
Well, it was over the plate.
I know, but remember we talked about getting reacquainted with the pitcher, seeing at least one pitch, because if everybody in the lineup would do that the first time at bat, each one would probably get three or four pitches, and by the third or fourth inning, the pitcher's pitched half a ball game.
Even in batting practice pitcher doesn't always throw the same speed. So when you get to see that pitcher, you've got to make an adjustment. I remember a perfect example of when you took the first pitch.
1946 All-Star Game in Fenway Park, and Ted Williams steps in against Rip Sewell of the National League. Sewell throws his famous Ephus pitch, a lazy lob, but Williams just watches it pass, sizing up the delivery. This time, Ted will be ready for it. Sewell throws it again, and there it goes. It could be. Yes, it is. It's Ted's fourth hit of the game and his second home run. The American League wins 12-0.
Okay, now, enough about Ted Williams. I want to see somebody in this bunch hit a couple.
If you don't mind, I got to admit, I've always had a dream of having Ted Williams watch me hit, analyze it, and teach me something about my swing. That felt great, Ted. I tell you, you've inspired me. What can I say? You still look as graceful as ever. I still think you can swing the bat, and maybe you'd take some cut for it. What do you think, Bunch?
Yeah!
Oh,
huh?
Boy.
Come on, Ted. Full time's sake.
Yeah!
Yeah, I hit one over the fence.
Send you back in Fenway Park, Thumper.
Yeah. Here, this'll make you feel a little more comfortable.
He's hard to refuse, isn't he?
Isn't she? All right, he's going. Yeah.
Okay, he tucked me in.
All right. Williams, all right, guys, over here.
Just throw a couple each. One time a couple, just
sit. Okay. Wow!
Remember our cheer? Two bits, four bits, two, four, six, eight. The baseball bunch appreciates.
Ted, wait. Two, four, six, eight. The baseball bunch appreciates.
To be a good hitter, you have to be a good student, and that means knowing your strike zone and learning which pitches you like best. He said you should wait for a ball that's in your sweet zone, and don't swing at pitches that are clearly not strikes. Ted also taught us that on good pitches, a slight upswing is best, and like Lou Piniella said, go down to meet a low pitch.